I'm Alex Michaelson. This week, the issue is California's coronavirus closures. We speak to a top emergency room doctor and one of the leading vaccine experts about our healthcare crisis. Plus, Congresswoman Karen Bass on the potential for a stimulus bill and her potential in the U.S. Senate. And Chef Andrew Gruel went viral this week with his fight to keep California restaurants open. He joins us as The Issue Is starts right now.
Broadcasting across California, California's only statewide political show. You're watching The Issue Is.
And welcome to The Issue Is. I'm Elex Michaelson. This week, Californians are being told to stay at home due to fears that coronavirus will overrun our hospital system. But there is good news when it comes to vaccines. This week, we're talking to doctors at the forefront of both issues. We begin with Dr. Mark Morocco. He specializes in emergency medicine at UCLA. He's an infectious disease expert who's been treated COVID-19 patients since the beginning of this pandemic. Doctor, welcome to The Issue Is, and thank you for all of your hard work on the front lines.
Oh, it's my pleasure, Alex. It's good to be here.
Let's begin by talking about what you're actually seeing. You know, we hear the governor talking about fears that emergency rooms, ICUs are going to be overrun. What are you seeing on the ground?
Well, the first thing I want to say to people all across the state is don't panic, right? So we are setting up for really war footing. We're getting ready for this incredible surge that when we were busy in April this past spring, we got a lot of patients, but we didn't get overwhelmed the way that New York did or Italy did. The numbers across the state and across the country now are so high and the virus is so widely spread that we're thinking that we're going to really get a giant surge. So we are ready to come out of the locker room and play the second half of this game against a team that's run up the score and take care of you no matter what your problem is. We're going to assume you have COVID as well. We've been seeing a ramp up in the total number of patients who are with COVID and obviously sick with COVID, and patients who come in for heart attacks or strokes or car accidents who turn out to have it and not even know they have it. So these people are really important to us because they are, I've used this movie metaphor, they're kind of like in a zombie film. They don't know they're zombies. They're out there spreading the virus, which is why all the things that we offer to people across the state of California, the reason we want you to get involved is there are easy ways you can help us. Wash your hands, wear your mask, avoid crowds, try not to travel. Do this for the next 6 weeks, and we can take the edge off of this giant surge and hopefully make the winter more of a convenience and less of a disaster.
Yeah, there's a lot of folks that think that these closures that are coming are not necessarily necessary based off of the science. What do you say to them?
If you want to be angry at somebody, be angry at people in the federal government who aren't willing to put some war-type money behind this war that we're fighting. You know, when we fought World War II, there was a huge expenditure of public money to support the people at home while we did something we had to do. We didn't spend the money because we wanted to, because it was necessary. And so the kind of stimulus that can support businesses and homes and renters and mortgages all across the state while we do this is so important.
Dr. Morocco, thank you for the life-saving work that you do every day. I know you've been working overtime, as has your staff, and please pass on our thanks to them as well.
We will do that, and we'll be there for you if you need us.
Thank you very much. Now let's talk about the race for a vaccine with one of the few doctors who will actually determine the order of who gets that vaccine first. Dr. Peter Szilagyi is a clinical researcher and pediatric specialist at UCLA. He's a member of Governor Newsom's Scientific Study Review Work Group and advises the CDC on immunization issues. Doctor, welcome to The Issue Is. Thank you for the work you're doing.
Thank you.
What a busy time this must be for you. All right, so the big question people want to know, when can I get my vaccine? How is this rollout going to work? Because we know healthcare workers get it first, but then how do you determine who gets it second, third, fourth, fifth?
Okay, so I'm a member of ACIP, which advises CDC, and we have spent 6 months deliberating who should get the vaccine first, given scarce supplies of the vaccine. We use the following principles. The first was science. So who is most at risk? For whom is the burden the highest? The second is implementation. How feasible is it to implement the vaccine? And the third and really important one is ethics. And based on those principles, we came up with the following order. Healthcare workers and residents in skilled nursing facilities should be the very first wave. The second wave is likely going to be essential workers. These are 87 million people who are essential for the economy, for society, to keep America going. And then there's two other high-risk groups, and those are adults with chronic conditions that place them at risk from getting COVID-19, so like heart, lung disease. And then there's 100 million of those. And then there are older adults, like myself, adults over 65, and there's 53 million. So it's likely it's going to be staged that way. I predict about 40 million doses by very early January. 40 million doses.
So that would be all healthcare workers, all nursing home facilities, and then beginning the essential workers by January?
By sometime in January. Sometime in January, I think we will roll in essential workers. Don't forget, we need two doses.
Right.
For these vaccines.
How do you determine which worker is more essential than the other when you have 87 million?
That's a really great question. It's really hard. It's like a Solomon's choice, isn't it? To try to decide who gets it first. But something that's really important, this is not going to take years. I mean, we're talking about for the essential workers, if they come next, they may all be able to get it within a couple of months. So when we're talking about somebody coming earlier rather than later, we're only talking about a couple of months. So I'm actually optimistic that by, maybe the summertime, July, August, we will be really heading out of this pandemic if the majority of people who can get the vaccine actually accept the vaccine.
Well, thank you for all that you do on this historic, unprecedented vaccine journey that we all are on. We really appreciate it. Up next, Congresswoman Karen Bass. But before we go with you, we like to play music on this show. And our pick for you is Here Comes the Sun by George Harrison, because you're giving us reason for optimism. I can sort of see the sun somewhere coming. Thank you. More of The Issue Is after this.
Today, we are announcing and introducing a regional stay-at-home order in the state of California.
Governor Newsom announcing his stay-at-home order, which will soon impact most of the state, and hoping, praying for some congressional relief for California. Let's talk about that and more with Democratic Congresswoman Karen Bass. She, of course, represents the 37th District in Congress, is the chair of the Congressional Black Caucus, and is a former speaker of the California Assembly and a frequent guest here. Congresswoman Bass, welcome back to The Issue Is.
Thank you. Thanks for having me on again.
All right, so let's begin with the governor's order. What do you say to folks in the restaurant, the beauty industries, others who say they're being unfairly targeted without a lot of scientific evidence, and they're really hurting, especially during the holidays?
Because there has lacked national leadership, there's so much confusion about the virus. So I feel sorry for all of us in California that we have to go through this, but I do believe that it is absolutely necessary. And I know when President-elect Biden is sworn in January, he's already said he's going to call for a national 100 days of everybody wearing a mask. So I do believe the next couple of months are going to be tough, but I believe after that, we really will be able to get control of this situation.
Folks specifically say in the restaurant industry, they say, look, there's not a lot of evidence that outdoor transmission at restaurants, so why are we shutting down? What do you say to some of those specific industries?
Well, again, I think there has been confusion over the science. But one thing that we all need to understand is that this is called the novel virus because it is new and science is learning as time goes on. And so one of the things that I believe we're going to have to do is a real education campaign about the virus. I can't think of anything I love more than eating out in restaurants. And there is evidence that people, when they are outdoors, they can still be sitting close, they are not wearing a mask, and it can still transmit. Now, it's much better than sitting at an indoor restaurant, right. But while we are peaking, while it is spiking, we just need to bring it back under control. I would also look at it a little differently in the sense that it is my responsibility here in Congress to make sure that we send relief to the restaurants, right. To the beauty shops, to the the nail shop so that they can survive while we're going through this. And I actually believe that there is light at the end of the tunnel. I think we're going to get a package done next week. It won't be the massive package that I think is needed, but I do believe that relief will be coming to the restaurants, to the beauty shops, so that they can survive the next couple of months.
So what does that actually look like for people that are really hurting right now? And why is it taking so long?
Well, I mean, in terms of what it looks like an extension of unemployment. It looks like the stimulus check of $1,200. And it also looks like an extension of the loans that hopefully will be forgiven for small businesses. But I say that in general terms because the negotiation is happening right now. But the way things go in Congress, I think all the signs are there that we will be able to get it done. And the specific signs are the Senate finally saying that they will agree to a package, and the president. Now, we have to keep the president focused until he signs it, because we do know that he can change his mind at any point in time. But I think that we will get there, and I think that we will get there next week.
You know, a big part of dealing with the coronavirus is getting people to comply and do a lot of the simple things that we all know people need to do. You know, in recent weeks, though, several of your Democratic colleagues have come under fire across the state for not following their own guidance when it comes to eating out. Are you worried that some of those messages might make it harder for people to listen? People say, if they're not going to do it, why should I do it?
I do think that that's the case. And as I recall, the ones that I've heard, they've all apologized and said they regretted it. But here's the thing. We need to have one message. The problem has been, as the president has refused to really take the virus seriously, and the news reporting has been all over the map, I am hoping that when the administration changes, we can cover this virus from the point of view of science and not politics.
So when we have a new administration, the current senator from California is going to become the vice president of the United States, which means there's an opening. So let's talk about you. You know, Governor Gavin Newsom can pick whoever he wants for that seat. I've offered my services. He laughed when I said it. Not many people are laughing about the possibility of you getting this job. There's a lot of buzz around you. Who knows if Governor Newsom is watching us on CBS 13 in Sacramento? Here's your chance. What's your pitch? Why should he pick you?
Well, you know what? I actually won't do a pitch. I will tell you that I do believe that there should be an African-American woman in the Congress. You know, when Senator Harris is sworn in as the vice president, there will be one African-American Democrat, one African-American Republican, no African-American women. And so I do think that's the case. I want you to know that I have a fabulous job right now. I hear my name being put out for a lot of different things. And if called upon to serve, I'll be there ready to serve. But I do think that it is important that we have representation in the U.S. Senate.
Because some might say, look, California has 40% Latinos, and we have not had a Latino in the United States Senate before. That group deserves representation, too. What do you say to them?
And I agree with that 100%. I think that is absolutely correct. And I think that that should happen. And we will see. We will see. I feel bad for the governor because he's in a heck of a spot. It's a tough decision to make. But I absolutely agree that there needs to be strong representation from our state.
You know, we like to have some fun on this show. So we like to play some games. We're going to play a game called the name game. This is one where we do one word or real short phrase to describe some well-known folks. And this week, we thought it would be interesting to talk about some of the outgoing members of the Trump administration and compare that with some of the incoming members of the Biden administration. All right, you ready?
Okay.
All right, one word to describe Donald Trump.
Unstable.
Rudy Giuliani.
Unstable.
Bill Barr, the Attorney General.
I mean, I would have to say corrupt.
Mitch McConnell, the Senate Majority Leader.
Sad.
Joe Biden, the President-elect.
Inspirational.
Kamala Harris, the vice president-elect.
History maker.
And you know, we love to play music on the show. And this week, with a big change coming, we leave you with some John Mayer, Waiting on the World to Change. Waiting on the world to change. the wait isn't going to last much longer. Congresswoman Bass, maybe Senator Bass, who knows? I think it sounds good. Up next, a California restaurant owner fighting back. More of The Issue Is after this. Thank you, Congresswoman.
Thank you. Good to see you again.
Outdoor dining does not lead to any of that. Therefore, screw that. We're staying open outdoors. It's that simple. I'm not. The governor is.
This video went majorly viral this week. Chef Andrew Gruel vowing to keep outdoor dining at his restaurants open despite upcoming closures by the state. Gruel joins us now. He owns 27 restaurants called Slapfish. He's been a judge on the Food Network and host of Say It to My Face on FYI. Chef, welcome to The Issue Is for the first time. Nice to have you.
Well, thank you so much for giving me the platform and having me on. I appreciate it.
All right, so here's your chance. What's your main message to the governor?
Well, you know, taking the saltiness out of my language, the main message to the governor is, you know, hey, to use his own cliche, we're really all in this together. And we're on board here. We've been on board since day one. Small businesses, restaurants, retail, we've been following every single step along the way, all of the mandates, all of the requirements, only to kind of get the hand to the face at every turn, every cul-de-sac, if you will. We follow the science and what it has shown based upon both the statistical data and his anecdotal behavior is that outdoor dining is not an issue. So don't make it an issue. If he can dine indoors with 22 of his closest friends, I can have my guests dine outdoors in the beautiful air, absorbing vitamin D and enjoying a meal.
You know, when LA County announced their closure for outdoor dining, they pointed to a CDC study from a few months ago that did not differentiate between indoor and outdoor dining. And so when it was announced on a statewide level this week, the governor and his Health and Human Services Secretary, Dr. Mark Galli, were pressed for the science behind this concerning outdoor dining. Neither of them really got into the specifics. Here's what Dr. Galli spoke about more in generality of why he's wanting to do this.
Today's message is not about how do we mix safely. It's about how we reduce our mixing altogether.
So his basic point is, look, there's a lot more coronavirus in the air than there was even a few months ago. So we need to act a little differently. Dining encourages mixing. So we're trying to limit mixing. So keep people from dining with a group of people. Does that make sense to you?
Look, I mean, if he's that serious about that standpoint, then shut down all the government offices. Let's stop airplanes. Let's stop going to Walmart, Target, all the big box stores. I don't think it's appropriate that we should be able to go to a head shop. I mean, you know, we can pick and choose and throw all of these items out on the table. But at the end of the day, we're intermingling in each one of these little scenarios. So, you know, it's just really hard to take that seriously when we can't follow the science because there's no science. I mean, coronavirus in the air, I just don't understand that. I mean, I do, but it doesn't necessarily make sense statistically. And then furthermore, when every single public official is breaking their own rules, the anecdotes don't prove to us that we should be following those particular pieces.
Let's talk for a moment, just on a real human level, of what this means for you and what this means for your employees.
Well, number one, I mean, me and the family, obviously, we want to hold it together. But the family includes the restaurant and all of our restaurant employees, team members, contractors, distributions, the guys who walk in the back door every single day who become your best friends. Those people are also losing their jobs or at risk of losing their jobs right before the holidays. In addition, we've always stood there in the community and tried to be a voice of charity. So we're always giving away free meals. We give away thousands of dollars of assistance and meals, et cetera. And it's really hard to do that when we're trying to protect our own and we don't even know what the next week is going to look like. You know, we invested thousands of dollars into outdoor heaters just last week only to find out, okay, we're not going to be able to use them. I mean, that's money I would have much rather given to my staff.
Right. On a lighter note, your Instagram, by the way, is filled with some amazing food pictures that like really made me hungry. And so a lot of us are spending more time at home these days cooking. Speaking of charity, what's the most important tip that you can give us? Oh my God, look at that.
You know, well, when it comes to seafood, right, you know, a great, incredibly healthy thing to eat, people are afraid to cook it because they don't want it to stick to the pan. So what I say is with any piece of fish, shellfish, anything, lightly rub it down with olive oil, fresh herbs, a little bit of vinegar, throw it in the oven at a low temperature for about, 10, 15 minutes, and you're going to have the most beautiful seafood, I promise you.
Oh, my God. Look at that. Ooh. I like your portion sizes too.
those are half portions. And look, sauce is boss.
Sauce is boss. I think regardless of your party, you can agree that sauce is boss. Yes, Chef, exactly. Thank you so much for speaking out.
Thank you very much.
Up next, my final word on a holiday season unlike any other. We end with a commentary. This week, thousands died of coronavirus. President Trump was busy tweeting nonstop about the crisis of voter fraud. Even though leaders in his own Justice and Homeland Security departments have publicly stated there's no evidence of it. Still, the president talked more about the possibility of dead voters than the actual Americans dying on his watch due to COVID. The only way we're going to beat this disease if we all come together and agree on some common sense solutions. That prospect was certainly made harder by hypocritical dinners by Democratic politicians and confusing orders from some of those same leaders based on some questionable science. It hasn't helped that for way too long, our dysfunctional Congress has failed to pass badly needed relief. Almost all aspects of our society, including the media, have made mistakes that have cost lives. But more people will die if we don't fix some of those mistakes right now. Our collective actions in this moment are critical. There's a lot we still don't know about the coronavirus, but we do know that it is not a hoax. We know that masks work, social distancing works, common sense works, and empathy works. And during this holiday season, unlike any we've ever seen before, perhaps the best gift you can give is mutual respect. I'm Elex Michaelson. Thanks for watching. The Issue Is, and happy holiday season.